will get started with tutorial. Problem number 39. What does problem number 39 tell? Problem number 39 tells, I have an aluminium plate heated to a uniform temperature of 227 degrees Celsius and is allowed to cool while being vertically suspended. This is natural convection. So, I think natural convection problem it is, we have solved problem number 39. So, I do not think we should be solving again. So, even that 40 is also natural convection. So, we have solved forced convection. All that we are saying is we have to compute the Rayleigh number and compute that. I think this is a plug-in problem. There is nothing difficult in that. So, what we shall solve now is, we shall take up 41. A furnace with an aperture of 20 mm diameter, a furnace of 20 mm diameter and an emissive power of 3.72 into 10 to the power of 5 watts per meter squared is used to calibrate a heat flux gauge having a sensitive area of 1.6 into 10 to the power of minus 5 meter squared. Area is 1.6 into 10 to the power of minus 5 meter squared. Okay. At what distance measured along a normal from the aperture should the gauge be positioned to receive irradiation of 1000 watts per meter squared? Irradiation is 1000 watts per meter squared. The question asked is, what should be the distance between the gauge and the
aperture
of the furnace. So, now you have taken it. So, G equal to, this is R, G equal to QFD, that is furnace to gauge upon AD is equal to IE intensity, D is the diameter for gauge.
The aperture.
Correct. Okay. IEAF, area of the aperture into cos theta F into omega df, that is the solid angle df, omega df upon ad. Okay. So, this is equal to, what is intensity? IE. What is intensity here? This is, we can be, this is coming out from a furnace. So, we can consider this as a like a black body. So, IE equal to Eb by pi, okay, Eb by pi into, we will substitute everything, AF, IE equal to Eb by pi, we will get G equal to, G equal to, that is 1000 equal to, G equal to 1000 equal to, Eb by pi is 3.72, Eb is what? Eb is, what is the irradiation given? Eb by pi,
3.72 times 10 to the power 5.
How did I get that? One second.
It is given to us.
Yeah, emissive power has been given to us, that is 3.72 into 10 to the power of 5 divided by pi. Yeah, either thickness. Okay. Divided by pi into AF. What is AF? That is pi by 4 into 20 into 10 to the power of minus 3 whole square, that is AF, that corresponds to, we will write AF equal to pi, AF equal to pi into 20 into 10 to the power of minus 3 whole square by 4, that is, that area turns out to be 1.6 into 10 to the power of minus 5 into cos theta
0,
cos theta f, it is normal, so 0 into a d cos theta d upon l squared. Remember, whenever I said there are two areas, they should be normal, normal to the irradiation. So, now here normal, again a d is given to be, what is the area given for a d? Yeah, that is pi by 4 d squared, that is coming out to be
correct only, no?
That is also 5 by 4.
1.6 times 10 to the power 5. This is pi by 4 d square, that is one area. This is given as the other area. See, we have.
Right. So, into.
It does not matter which we are putting, but divided,
into
divided by
r squared, divided by r squared. That is it. So, if I get, I will get r equal to point.
So, let me just write here, omega d f is
a d cos theta d
divided
upon l square,
r square or l,
l square. So,
a d is what? Area of
the aperture.
Correct?
Okay.
That is one.
Okay. So, fine. So, we get L equal to 0.193 meters. Okay. So, if the gauge is tilted, if the gauge is tilted off normal by 20 degrees, what will be its irradiation? So, it will be 1000 into cos 20. G at 20 degrees, G at 20 degrees would be G at 20 degrees is 1000 into cos 20. So, that turns out to be 940 watts per meter square.
The fraction wala karna hai, we will do it for the heck of it. Ye to kar lete.
Radiation ka sab karte hai.
Kar lete. Aaj we have time also.
A glass plate. Let us take problem number 42, that is a glass plate 30 centimeter square is used to view radiation from a furnace, that is the glass plate is 30 centimeter square.
Okay.
30 centimeter square glass plate, that is 30 into 30 centimeter squared. Okay. The transmissivity of the glass is 0.5 from 0.2 to 3.5 micrometer, that is lambda 1 equal to 0.2 micrometer and lambda 2 equal to 3.5 micrometer. That means rest all other wavelengths, the transmissivity is 0. That is what we need to assume.
Yeah.
Okay? So, all that we are saying is there is a transmissivity of the glass only within a wavelength of 0.2 to 3.5 micrometers. Anything less than 0.2 micrometer, it is having transmissivity 0. Anything above 3.5 micrometers, it is having 0. Now, the emissivity of the glass. Yeah. So, next sentence, the emissivity of the glass may be assumed to be 0.3 up to 3.5 micrometers and 0.9 above that. So, if you plot that emissivity versus lambda 0.3 up to 3.5 micrometer, and now at 3.5 micrometer there is a sudden jump and that will take to 0.9, and there from there on till infinity it is going to be infinity, means it is not infinity, that is until thermal radiation is contributed, we will have an emissivity of 0.9, and the transmissivity of the glass is 0 except in the range of 0.2 to 3.5 micrometers. I stated that already. Assuming that the furnace is a black body at 2000 degree Celsius. The black body, that is this glass plate, is, see, in a furnace typically we put a glass so that we can see what is happening inside a furnace. Okay. So, that is what we are trying to do, the energy balance for this glass. So, assuming that the furnace is a black body and sitting at 2000 degree Celsius, what is the energy absorbed by the glass and how much energy is transmitted through the glass outside? That is the question which is asked. Okay. So, we have studied fraction of energy transmitted yesterday. So, if we take that concept, if you remember, we can go to the table, lambda 1 t table is there, that is lambda, we have listed the fraction as a function of lambda t, is not it? So, let us first calculate lambda 1 t and lambda 2 t and then we will go to the table. So, what is lambda 1 t? Lambda 1 is lambda 1 t, that is 0.2 micrometer, 0.2 into t is 2273. Where did I get this 2273 from? 2000 plus 273. Remember, in radiation always we have to keep temperature in Kelvin. 2273, I get 454.6 micrometer Kelvin. Similarly, lambda 2 t, I get 3.5 into 2273, 7955.5 micrometer Kelvin. Okay. So, now let us go to the table
radiation.
So, for lambda 1 t, 454.6, that means it is somewhere between 400 and 600, that is 0. Okay. So, F, no, F
capital F
0 lambda 1, 0 to lambda 1 is 0. Now, for lambda 2 t is 7955. Let us go back to the table again. That is, let us see for 8000, 7955 we would not get. If we see 8000, it is around 0.856. So, we will get F 0 lambda 2 as 0.85.
Zoom, how did it get zoomed? This is the value.
This is the value, 0.856288.
Okay. Mistakes are always useful.
F 0 lambda 2 is 0.85443. Okay. So, F of 0 lambda is equal to
F of,
no, we will not do that, I will not write, let us not write that. Let us just sigma t to the power of 4. See, total incident radiation, if we compute, we are supposed to find the calculate the energy absorbed in the gas and the energy transmitted. So, we are supposed to find the energy transmitted. Now, let us find what is the energy absorbed. What is the energy absorbed?
If this is the glass plate,
hmm,
G is coming from furnace.
Hmm. And what is getting transmitted? Hmm. What is it being falling? Sigma T to the power of 4 is falling.
That is because it is black.
0.3 squared is the area. Okay. So, transmitted radiation is equal to, this is sigma t to the power of 4 and area is 0.3 into 0.3. Okay. So, total incident radiation equal to, first of all let us find out total incident radiation equal to, total incident radiation equal to sigma t to the power of 4, total incident radiation equal to sigma t to the power of 4 into area into F of, actually it is lambda 1 to lambda 2. But what is this f lambda 1 to lambda 2 equal to? F of 0 to lambda 2 minus f of 0 to lambda 1. Okay. So, let us substitute all this. I get, yeah. So, sigma is 5.67 into 10 to the power of minus 8, 2273 to the power of 4, 0.85443 into 0.3 square. I get 11,6381.7 watts. So, this is the incident radiation that is coming from the furnace. But how much is getting transmitted? If we see the graph of the transmissivity, see, it is getting transmitted only between 0.2 to 3.5. That is why we also calculated what is the incident radiation within that bandwidth, that is 0.2 micrometer to 3.5 micrometer. So, what will we get? Total radiation transmitted. What is the transmissivity within this bandwidth? We have 0.5. How much is falling? We have the G. So, 0.5 into G is the
G transmitted.
G transmitted. How do you, okay. Should we show the transparency?
No, 1 minute. I just want to say the why we did what we did here. Okay, just 1 minute. You might be understanding why we did this. Why we took from 0.2 to 3.5 is because we could have taken from 0 to infinity. But the thing is, even if you have energy incident over all wavelengths, the energy that is useful for this case is only what is coming between 0.2 to 3.5 micrometers. So, there itself we have used this fraction. Okay.
Nothing else is going to go through that otherwise. It might be falling onto it, but nothing is going to go through it.
Yeah.
Okay. So, total radiation transmitted equal to 0.5 into 116381.7, which turns out to be 58190.85.
Now, I would just like to add one thing here. In this problem, see, actually we have this tau which is a constant in this range. Okay, so, we just took it as 0.5. If in this range also tau had some variation, then we would have had to go through that integration to get the actual value of tau. We will not do it for this problem. There are a couple of other problems where we will have to do an integrated value for tau or epsilon or alpha, whatever, and the procedure will be similar.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay. So, we are leaving the other portion for yourself to work out, that is the energy absorbed in the gas. You please work out yourself, because they have to do the same thing. Okay. So, energy absorbed in the glass, you will be working out yourself, because we have emissivity of the gas given. So, from which you will have to work out the energy absorbed. Okay. So, let us move on. Gas. Okay. So, now I think if we have any questions here and there, we will take.
Sir, my question is that, sir, in case of suppose we are considering a flame, yesterday you told that suppose you are considering a blue flame, it is having an emissivity of 0.2 to 0.3 something.
It
must be having some absorptivity term or transmittivity term along with that. Now, how is the flame going to absorb? Okay. Now, my question is, how is the flame going to absorb something? So, flame is something which is doesn't have any mass. It is just a radiation. So, how is that absorbing any other radiation, or it is absorbing a radiation, or it is transmitting anything?
Okay. See, one of the question is, yesterday we broached up that there is a flame, because one of the questions was how does the blue flame, how does the blue flame affect the heat transfer on my pan. So, what did we say? If I have a blue flame, where did this blue flame come from? The question, there is no mass in the flame is the not right thing. There is mass, there is mass. What is this mass consisting of? It is what is coming inside. First is methane. Let me take simple. In a LPG, of course, there will be butane and propane also. I am just taking methane gas or a hydrocarbon. Let me put it very safe way answering is hydrocarbon. You have an hydrocarbon and you are taking oxygen plus nitrogen, that is air, oxygen and nitrogen, other extraneous things I am excluding. So, if you take this, what is that which is there in the flame? If the complete combustion takes place, so you get CH4 plus O2, you get what?
CO2
and of course, nitrogen is sitting here and you will have nitrogen and you will have H2O also. Okay? So, do not say that there is nothing inside the flame, there is mass. Okay? That is this carbon dioxide, nitrogen and water vapor. Now, that we are talking about emissivity, absorptivity of these components, carbon dioxide, nitrogen and water vapor. What we are saying is that because it is complete combustion, it is blue flame, number one. Number two, its emissivity, not 0.2, it is almost 0.03. If the complete combustion is taking place, it is almost 0.02 to 0.03. So, if it is 0.03, what does that mean? What does that mean? Emissivity equal to absorptivity. Absorptivity is also equal to 0.03. Assuming that there is no reflectivity, which is true for the flame, there is no reflectivity, what is the transmissivity? 1 minus 0.03, that is 0.97. That means what? Everything is getting transmitted through it. It is a non-participating gas. That is why I said there is no radiation from the flame to the human body or to the plate. Whatever heat transfer is taking place between the blue flame and the plate is completely or majorly dominated by convective heat transfer. Convective heat transfer. The mode of the heat transfer between the blue flame and the plate what I am putting on my gas stove is convective heat transfer majorly. If we nitpick maybe 3 to 5%, it would be radiation because that radiation contribution is because of this small emissivity. And of course, there are lot of chemical reactions and all are there. There will be a thermochemical heat release also, what is called as TCHR. Let us not get into all of that. Majorly, the heat transfer is convection. So, please do not say that there is no mass in my flame. There is mass. What is that mass? That is consisting of carbon dioxide, nitrogen and water vapor. Is this an assumption? No, this is experimentally measured value. Okay? This is experimentally measured value. We ourselves have measured this actually. So, we put a thermocouple and put a thermal camera the way I explained in the morning and we have measured the emissivity of the LPG flame. So, it is coming around 0.03, even lesser than that.
Sir, in another one, I have another question. So, in temperature measurement by using thermometer, you said that we have to consider the temperature of the wall, it will affect the thermometer reading. Temperature reading in a thermometer. So, suppose in case of a fluid which is having a very high temperature, do you want to take the radiation effect of the fluid? Will it affect the temperature measurement by using thermometer?
The question asked is in the radiation error, in the radiation deviation, what did we say? What did we say? T fluid is equal to T thermocouple plus sigma epsilon thermocouple into T thermocouple minus T wall
to the power 4.
T thermocouple to the power of 4, T wall to the power of 4 upon H. But now, what you are saying is that if there is a fluid and that fluid is moving, and let us say water. But water is not participating, no. Water is not participating and even if you take air for example, that is not participating. As long as there is, if we take participating medium, it becomes complicated. It is much difficult than what we have told. If it is non-participating, then I do not think there is any problem in calculations of this. Did I answer your question?
Suppose it is having a very high temperature fluid. Suppose a 700 degree or 800 Kelvin fluid is used, will it affect? Now it will be also having a mass which is emitting radiation, no?
See, the question is, if the fluid which is flowing is also sitting at high temperature, will it affect? So that is what, it is not a function of temperature, it is a function of participation.
So this, in fact, this T fluid here could be 700, 800, how does it matter?
Yeah, the here in the problem what we took itself is was, it was quite high temperature actually. So fluid temperature is not the issue, the issue is whether my fluid is participating or not, that is all the issue is. Okay.
Okay. Instead of water, if in the same place there is mixture of air, I mean, so instead of air, if it is air plus some steam, then it is a different problem. It will be difficult. Okay. So when it is air at that high temperature, it is not going to be participating. Even if there is some amount of water vapor, it will start to become participating. That is what will matter. The temperature might be the same for the two fluids, but the nature of the interaction is different. So that is what is more
important. What is the interaction we are looking at? Okay, even if I have a participating medium, what will happen? So what will happen? My thermocouple, whatever temperature is there, the fluid cannot transmit or radiate the heat to the wall. That is being stunted by the medium which is there. So in fact, the participation, the radiation from the fluid to the wall, sorry, from the fluid to the wall, of course, there is no radiation, but from the thermocouple
to the wall
is minimized. In fact, it is good, no? My radiation error is going to come down actually. Is that okay?
How do we identify the participation? Is it depend upon viscosity or something like that? A degree of participation, how do we identify a medium is participating or not? Does it depend upon the emissivity of the medium or something like
that? The question is, how does one make out whether a medium is participating or non-participating? I think let us wait till tomorrow morning. I have planned that I will be giving that participating medium's transmissivity, emissivity and the, of course, again as you said, whether they are participating or not will be dependent on emissivity and absorptivity. If their emissivity and absorptivity are equal to 0, then transmissivity is 1. We say that in the morning itself we said, if I have a gas whose absorptivity is almost equal to 0, that is, which is the case of optically thin medium, then its transmissivity is equal to 1. As long as any medium has having a transmissivity of 1, everything which will come through it will pass through it. So, any medium which is having transmissivity equal to 1 is a non-participating medium. Okay? So, if I have to imagine in terms of emissivity, absorptivity, reflectivity, transmissivity, is if it is a gas, there is no reflectivity, so it is only transmissivity. It should be having 100% transmissivity. If you have 100% transmissivity, then my medium is non-participating.
Okay.
Okay? We will come out from this college now.
Natural convection experiment, if the geometry is changed from rectangular block to cylindrical block, so we will be considering all entire surfaces for the calculating Nusselt number, no? So what would be the difference?
Yeah, in the natural convection experiment, if I take a cylinder instead of a flat plate, can I go ahead and do the natural convection? In fact, it will be good, I think. That is a good idea actually. So instead of taking a flat plate, one can even take a cylinder. But only thing is that, yeah, we can take a cylinder and do the experiment, there is no problem. You can go ahead and do this, maybe making a cylinder block is much easier than making a flat plate. One can try this, this is a very good idea, really good idea. We can go ahead and that way actually you are given idea that any shape we can do, as long as I can get that shape in ice. And with ice getting any shape is easy because template is in our hands.
The question is related to absorptivity. Yeah, very much. So, in your slide, there is a tree whose temperature 300 Kelvin and the sun temperature around 5000 Kelvin and the absorptivity related to the source temperature. In that case, at a low temperature, source have a high absorptivity. Why it is so?
The question is that in that slide with a house roof, sun is at 5800 Kelvin, absorptivity is 0.3, a tree is at 300 Kelvin, absorptivity for that is 0.6 or something.
Yes.
So, is it that for the roof material, absorptivity decreases with increase in temperature?
Radiation
3. No, this is not that absorptivity decreases with.
What is it?
No, oh, okay.
Temperature.
Yeah, absorptivity is. Okay, this question actually we had in our class also. Okay, I am just trying to open, please bear with me. See, the point here is the absorptivity is a function of source temperature. So, your question is this source is sitting at one temperature, another source is sitting at temperature. Is that because of that the absorptivity is less? No, I cannot make a conclusion like that.
I cannot make a conclusion that absorptivity of the roof decreases with increase in temperature.
No. So, because each source is the source of each one is different. See, it is a function of absorptivity, is a function of source material and source temperature and source material properties, like whether it is rough or smooth and things like that. Okay.
Actually, if these are the separate sources, consider only the tree, then absorptivity is 0.9, high value. For the separate source as the sun, its absorptivity is 0.6. The temperature is high, that time absorptivity is less compared to 300 Kelvin source. That's my question.
Yeah, the question we have understood. Your question is tree temperature is 300 Kelvin, that's why my absorptivity is 0.9, and sun's temperature is 5780 Kelvin, my absorptivity is 0.6. So, absorptivity decreases with the increase of temperature.
No,
that's what we are saying. We have got your question. The conclusion is wrong, just because this is an example which just shows that the absorptivity of the building material is a function of which source it is coming from. I am not told that this temperature is less, that's why it is less.
See, sun is going to energy coming from the sun is going to have this spectrum, the last one 5800. For that 5800 Kelvin spectrum which is there, absorptivity of this roof material is 0.3. Now, tree is not going to emit at this spectrum, no? It is going to be at a different temperature, its characteristic of emission is going to be different. So, it will have a spectrum which is different. For that spectrum, the absorptivity is 0.9. Okay, now if the
incidentally the temperatures are like that there, that is one is less and the other one are.
So, do not look at temperature in isolation, look at the source. It is a different source altogether. Two different sources at same temperature, absorptivity of from that. Let us say I have source 1 which is at 500 Kelvin, another source 2 at 500 Kelvin. Absorptivity of that roof for source 1 will be different from absorptivity at source 2.
Very right.
It is not related to temperature alone.
Yes.
By chance it may come out to be the same, that is okay,
that is
but
incidental.
It is incidental. It is not necessarily a function of temperature alone. Okay, it is a nature of the emission or nature of irradiation coming out from that surface to this surface. Okay.
Do this.
Okay. So, we will take up.
I hope we have uploaded both tutorials.
Today when you should have uploaded this?
Okay. Problem 46.
It is a slightly involved problem.
Okay. 46. A small workpiece is placed in a large oven having isothermal walls at TF equal to 1000 Kelvin.
This is F we are calling because furnace. Okay, so subscript F is for that. Okay.
With an emissivity of 0.5, that is furnace wall is having an emissivity of 0.5. The workpiece experiences convection with moving air at 600 Kelvin, T infinity is 600 Kelvin and convective heat transfer coefficient is 60 watts per meter squared Kelvin. The surface of the workpiece has a spectrally selective coating whose spectral emissivity varies as epsilon lambda equal to 0.2 for lambda 1 equal to 0 to 5 micrometers. And from 5 micrometers to infinity, we have 0.8. These are the inputs. What is the question asked? Perform an energy balance on the workpiece and determine the steady state temperature TS. Let's try to solve this problem. It's little lengthy. Be prepared.
And it is a little bit involved. So you might have questions. Please wait till the end. I have drawn a furnace or the oven here. This rectangle. It is at temperature TF having emissivity 0.5. This is that work piece. It is much smaller than the enclosure. So, I have arbitrarily drawn it as a circle, does not mean anything. It could be any arbitrary shape. I am taking a control volume around this one. So, I have to do energy balance. So, some energy is coming in, some energy is going out.
So, what is the mode of energy which is coming in?
Very carefully we have to write this. So,
E dot in minus E dot out equal to 0, because there is no E dot G and E dot ST term. So, what is E dot in? E dot in should be the irradiation. Irradiation means it should be coming from the furnace wall. So, E dot in equal to epsilon, E dot in equal to epsilon F sigma T f to the power of 4. Why I am telling this only this much means? What is this? Epsilon f sigma T f to the power of 4? Sameer, what is this? Epsilon f sigma T f to the power of 4? Emissive power of what? Of the furnace. Emissive power of the furnace. Is that equal to what my body has taken? That is the irradiation. How much my body has taken is dependent on what? Yes? Absorptivity. That is, this has to be multiplied by the absorptivity of my body. Very important. This is where we will go wrong. Alpha
not of furnace but of
source. My source is emitting epsilon f sigma T f to the power of 4. That is
alpha of the object. Alpha of the body,
not workpiece. My workpiece can take only as much as my absorptivity allows it to take. It cannot take more than that. So this is E dot in. Now let us write E dot out. E dot out can be of two modes. One is convection, another one is radiation. H into Ts minus T infinity plus epsilon S Eb at Ts, that is sigma Ts to the power of 4 E epsilon S. So, this is equation 1.
So, these two are equated. So, I will get alpha S epsilon F sigma Tf to the power 4 minus sigma S, epsilon S sigma Ts to the power 4 minus Hts minus T infinity equal to 0. So, this is my governing equation. In this, this quantity is for the workpiece, this quantity is for the workpiece, this is for the workpiece. We have to find this quantity. It occurs here, as we see, it is a nonlinear equation, first of all. Now, alpha S also is not given to us directly, sigma S also is obviously not given to us directly. So, we have to get these two somehow to get temperature. That is what we are going to do.
So, first let us find out alpha S. Alpha equal to, we know, we have written already the relation, alpha equal to in the numerator 0 to infinity alpha lambda g lambda d lambda upon integral g lambda d lambda 0 to infinity. okay, but alpha lambda equal to epsilon lambda. So, alpha equal to epsilon equal to 0 to infinity in the numerator, 0 to infinity epsilon lambda, g lambda can be visualized as E b lambda at this is, you see, it is irradiating from the furnace. So, furnace we can take it as a black body. Okay. So, E b lambda T f upon E b of T f. Yeah, sorry, I made a wrong statement. We are not taking furnace as a black body. I am multiplying that with epsilon lambda. It cannot be black body. Otherwise, if it is having a black body, then its emissivity will be equal to 1. It is not there. So, I am multiplying epsilon lambda into E b lambda T f. Okay. So, now, I have to take fraction. What is the fraction which it allows? We will have to see the, we will have to see what we have plotted just now. Professor has plotted.
Just one second, what will the confusion be? In fact, when I write this, each time I get confused. See, this alpha and epsilon are for the work piece. Okay. This epsilon, I mean this E b is the furnace emissive power. Okay, that is obvious. What we have assumed is that this distribution, spectral emissivity distribution for the work piece, is the same as spectral absorptivity
of the work piece.
That's so, Kirchhoff's law is valid this way, epsilon lambda equal to alpha lambda, epsilon is not equal to alpha, epsilon lambda equal to alpha lambda for the work piece, that is what.
That is,
and bear in mind this thing is, this is going to be dealt with at 1000 Kelvin, because energy is coming in at 1000 Kelvin.
That's right.
Okay.
So, this is that, as professor said, this is where most of us will get confused. Okay. So, okay. So, now what is lambda 1 and lambda 2? Lambda 1 T f
is equal to 5, na? 5 here.
No, we will just flash it.
Yeah, 5 times
here lambda 2, lambda 3.
Sorry.
Oh, 5 into 1000. So, you get 5000 micrometer Kelvin, and lambda 2 into T f is, yeah,
okay,
5000 lambda T, you get 0.6337.
Yeah. So, for this I will get
F 0 lambda 2 lambda 1 as 0.6337, that is enough actually.
Yeah.
That is enough. So, epsilon equal to,
therefore, epsilon of what?
Epsilon of the work piece.
At what temperature? Based on Tf.
Tf equal to
alpha s is equal to
0.2 into point, where did this 0.2 come from?
0.2 has come from this distribution here. This is 0.2
into 0 to 5 micrometer. That is
that fraction.
That fraction, that is 0.2 into 0.6337 plus 0.8 into
1 minus 0.6,
because the emissivity is 0.8 for all
other wavelengths
greater than 5 micrometer
up to infinity.
So this turns out to be, there itself you write my top 0.419. See, that is what professor has emphasized. This alpha s is based on T f. Okay. Now, using this alpha, where will I use this? In my previous equation.
We can flash that.
Yeah. This governing equation. This one has to be solved. So, I got alpha s 0.419, but I do not know epsilon s. And the most common mistake that which most of us would have made, even we would have made probably, is that we would have taken alpha s equal to epsilon s. That is wrong. Why is it wrong? Because this alpha was computed based on
furnace temperature,
which is 1000 Kelvin. This is married to T subscript s, because that is based on the temperature of the work piece. Okay. So, I do not know T s, nor do I know epsilon.
let us write the equation so in terms of epsilon s and ts.
Okay, so I will rewrite this equation now.
I will tell that equation again for you. Epsilon f,
epsilon
f, epsilon f,
epsilon f,
alpha s,
sigma
tf to the power of 4,
tf to the
equal to or minus
equal
to h into ts minus t infinity,
h into ts minus t infinity
plus epsilon s sigma ts to the power of 4. By the way, this was our end sem question.
Final
this
exam.
Time.
Final exam.
Final exam. End semester examination question.
So, this is known 0.5 given to us very nicely. This we have calculated 0.419.
Sigma
TF,
we know.
This is 1000 Kelvin. So, left hand side we know. So, this quantity we know.
H is 60.
So, this is also known. T infinity is known. Sigma.
T infinity is 600.
So, I have epsilon s and T s as unknown. What do I do? How do I solve this? So, I know by intuition, by observation that T infinity is going to be 600 given,
T self is
1000 given.
So, it has to be
between these two. So, logically the first thing I can take is assume T s to be equal to 800 Kelvin. Okay. So, for 800 Kelvin, I have my epsilon distribution given already, this one 0.2, 0.8. This 5 micrometer, this was already drawn earlier, that one is there. So, knowing temperature T s, I will find lambda T s assumed, get a value, get a fraction associated with this one, okay, and then evaluate epsilon using
epsilon 1 into
epsilon 1 into
f of 0 lambda 1 t.
Lambda 1 T s
plus
epsilon
2
into
1 minus
f 0 to lambda 1 T s. Okay, so, this fraction I will get based on the assumed temperature
800 Kelvin.
So, for 800 Kelvin, I will go to the table, get this fraction, I have the distribution, I will get a new epsilon s, calculated value of epsilon s. Substitute this epsilon s and T s on this equation right hand side. Left hand side is a number which I know, right hand side I will substitute. Obviously, it is not going to match. So, then I will go to a next value. If the right hand side is more, that means energy out is coming out to be more. So, I should make a judgment based on that. So, I should take a lower value of,
or I will substitute this epsilon and get T s,
yes,
and take that T s to compute again new epsilon.
That is also,
I will go on doing this until my
convergence is reached, left hand side equal to right hand side. So, after doing that,
what we get an epsilon of,
okay, thik, I'll no, I do not want to waste another page.
Chalega,
okay. So, so, after substituting 2-3 times,
by trial and error, you get epsilon equal to 0.57 and T s equal to 680 Kelvin. Note, please note, what was the alpha s?
419
at furnace temperature of 1000 Kelvin. Our epsilon s is different. Why? Because my furnace temperature is at 1000, but my surface is at 680 Kelvin. So, see, although Kirchhoff's law is there, always epsilon is not equal to alpha. Please remember that. We always abuse Kirchhoff's law on this note. So, we have to say the temperatures have to be the same. Okay. Source is not going to be at the same temperature as my body.
If source is at the same temperature of the body, the problem is gone. There is
no radiation.
Okay. Yeah. So, we are laughing, but even probably if you were a student, we would have made
made a mistake. Okay. That is another thing. There is no question which is trivial in this world as long as I understand that. So, I think we should, as teachers, we should make a conscious effort to not to use these words. I at least make a conscious effort not to use these words, trivial and obvious. Actually, I have developed a habit to hate these words. Why? Because these words put off the audience actually. They think that this is too trivial and I am asking something very trivial. Nothing is trivial until I understand. So, I think if we get into that comfort zone, that is if the teacher and the student gets into that comfort zone, that I can ask this teacher any nonsensical thing and I can get an meaningful answer, that is the ambience I need to create in the class. That's why, in fact, if you have watched me, I have gone to every center and pestered you for question. Why? Because we need to inculcate our students also to ask questions, not put the questions under the carpet and go home. Okay? So this is what we need to understand. Okay, we will take quickly one or two questions if they are there anywhere. Okay. The question is, what is the influence of distance between the thermal camera and my object on the measurement of temperature? Now, see, basic question, how is my thermal camera working? It is capturing the thermal radiation. It has to transmit through me the air. So, how does that matter? Where do I keep my camera? It is, as long as my, in fact, in all of this, air is non-participating. That is not an assumption, that is indeed true. So, because air is non-participating medium, that is why my camera is able to capture. If air were to be participating, my camera will be seeing something less. It cannot see complete heat flux, the radiative heat flux which is incident on it. Okay? So, the answer is the thermal camera is independent of the distance between the source and the thermal camera. But if you take very far away distance, what will happen? Your number of pixels are fixed, no? I said typically 320 by 240 pixels. So, if you go far away, your resolution of the object what you are seeing is going to get decreased. That is all it is. Because you are going to see your full object in maybe few pixels. If you go closer, your complete 320 by 240 pixels you would have used. That is all it is.
Will the absorbability depends only on the source temperature? Will it not depend on the receiver?
Will absorptivity depend only on the source temperature? Will it not depend on the receiver's temperature?
Oh, yeah. Will the absorptivity dependent only on the source temperature but not the sink temperature, that is the receiver's temperature? Yes, it is not dependent on the receiver's temperature. It is dependent only on the source temperature.
But energy transfer, heat transfer interaction, net heat flow rate will change depending on the source temperature.
That is the energy balance.
Alpha will not change.
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
What about receiver's properties?
Receiver's properties.
That is what we are saying. No, it is not dependent on the receiver's properties. It is dependent on the source only. See, this is the general perception. This is what we have been telling again and again. Absorptivity is not dependent on the receiver's properties or temperature or its surface roughness. The absorptivity of any material is dependent only on the incident, that is the source temperature.
Sir, another question, sir.
Okay.
While defining solid angle, we took the sphere. But while defining emissivity or radiosity or irradiation, we took only hemisphere only. What could be the reason, sir?
What you were there yesterday morning? Because we went through this, I'll repeat for the sake of being repetitive. See, in our normally radiation is going in all will go in all directions, so you will get a sphere. But in heat transfer applications that we are dealing with, we are dealing with interaction from one surface to another. So, if this energy is coming on from a source like a tube light, you are looking at what is coming down to us. So, we are looking at only the bottom part or the top part if things are going from here to upper part of the room. So, if I have a source of light in this room, I am looking primarily from the, it is as if I am covering the bottom part by a cardboard and just looking at the top part.
Correct.
So that I get a hemisphere. Okay.
If there is, let us say, if both the sides of the plate are emitting something, let us say,
then
so I will have two hemispheres, this hemisphere and again this hemisphere.
That is all. See, even in natural convection, you know, we said that one side is insulated, we are taking only the other side, but we have solved problems where a plate is suspended and we have coolly multiplied everything by a factor of two. Exactly the same.
Once we know one half, the other half can always be built upon.
What are the different methods to measure the heat transfer coefficients? Of course, you told using the lumped capacity. Apart from that, is there any other methods to find the heat transfer coefficient practically?
Okay. actually it's a very big, the question asked is what are the methods to measure the heat transfer coefficient. There are plenty of methods to measure the heat transfer coefficient. One of the methods is what we told yesterday, that is the lumped capacitance. So, but it is in case of internal pipe, let us say if you want to measure the internal pipe, what should I do? I should take a pipe, okay, and wind wire, that is wire should be as close as possible, there should not be any gap. So, why I am winding the wire? This is the nichrome wire which is having a thin insulation around it, so that I can maintain constant heat flux boundary condition. That is, I will supply voltage into current upon pi into d into L, that is d is the diameter of the pipe and L is the length of the pipe. So, I get the heat flux. Now, if I measure, if I put thermocouples on the plate, on the pipe at various locations, so I get wall temperature. But how do I get the bulk temperature? For the bulk temperature, we said that bulk temperature is going to, for constant heat flux boundary condition, temperature versus x, professor has taught us that the surface temperature and the bulk temperature are going to be parallel to each other. I can measure only the bulk temperature at the inlet and bulk temperature at the exit. Okay? So, in between the two, I will assume linear. So, wherever I have measured the wall temperature, I will use this linear relationship and get the bulk temperature. So, that is how I have the bulk temperature at every location and wall temperature I have measured at every location possibly where I can put the thermocouple. Now, Q double dash equal to H into T wall minus T bulk. So, H equal to Q double dash upon T wall minus T bulk.
Assuming fully developed.
This is assuming fully developed flow. If it is not fully developed flow, bulk fluid temperature is difficult to, no, bulk fluid temperature will still be linear.
Only the delta T will be.
Yeah, even in developing flow, I can measure this, there is no problem. Correct. Because even if it is developing flow, it will be like this, this would not be there. But the bulk fluid temperature is going to vary linearly, that cannot change. Okay? So, this is how one can measure the heat transfer coefficient. If I want to get the local, what should I do? I should not use this pipe as a copper pipe. I should use SS pipe and that too thin pipe I should do. I should use. Why? Because there is no lateral conduction within my pipe. It is only going to, what is outer wall temperature. I am measuring two things. That is, I am measuring outer wall temperature, but actually I need inner wall temperature. So, if I have thin, the conduction within this is going to be minimal and I am going to get the same temperature. So, the conductivity has to be as low as possible so that my lateral conduction is avoided and thickness has to be so small because the inner surface temperature should be equal to the outer surface temperature. That is the differentiation. I have told you only one method. Actually, there are several methods. You please put this question on the Moodle. I will put it across. I will answer, but I think I will tell you one more method just for the heck of it. Let us take, because I will tell with reference to thermal camera. So, now let us say I have a flat plate. As I said in the morning, I have taken a flat plate. Let me take a natural convection situation. Why every time forced? I have told for external flows. So, now I am going to tell for natural convection. Let me take a thin metal foil. As I said in the morning, I have explained why thin, 0.05 mm thickness, which is the paper thickness if I take that and give direct DC power supply. In the morning, I had explained you why DC power supply. If I give DC power supply, because if it is a thin metal foil, resistance equal to rho L by A, cross sectional area is less, so resistance is we want to increase. But still, if I take nichrome foil or a stainless steel foil, resistance will be very less. So, current will be very high, voltage will be very less. It is a safe way of doing experiments. If you and I touch that foil, nothing will happen. So, if I give the DC power supply for this, now what will happen? It will measure the, I am giving constant heat flux boundary condition. Okay? Now, I will get the wall temperature everywhere using the thermal camera, provided I have painted this with lamp black, let us say, because emissivity is known. So, from the thermal camera, I get temperature at every pixel you are going to get. Heat flux equal to h into T wall minus T infinity. Ambient I know, wall temperature at every pixel I have measured, and Q double dash is nothing but voltage into current divided by the area of my plate. Okay, that will give my heat transfer coefficient. In all of this, in all of these methods, what is very important is to characterize the losses. Like in ice experiment, there was radiation losses. Here also, I have to deduct the radiative. There is radiative heat transfer also while there is natural convection from this plate. I have to deduct that from my voltage into current. That is sigma into epsilon into Ts to the power of 4 minus T infinity to the power of 4. At every pixel, I have to deduct that. Okay, if I do that, I will be getting the natural heat transfer coefficient. These are not that it is a comprehensive, we have covered everything. There are tens of methods of measurement, laser interferometry is there. There are lots of methods, there are lots of methods, but everyone uses constant heat flux with a heater wire and a thermocouple because it is very easy to do in the lab and you do not need much money to do that. Okay?
I have one question. Why lamp black? Then this is going to be more.
No, why lamp black? The question asked is why lamp black? The answer is if I have lamp black, the emissivity of that lamp black is known, which is the input which I have to give to thermal camera, then only I will get the temperature. Okay? Okay, so I think, yeah, there are some questions.
Surat.
SVNIT Surat. Ah, okay, ah, go okay. ahead.
Sir, we have some confusion regarding the value of alpha for the black body. Is it depend on temperature for the black body also?
Yeah, but it depends on the temperature for the black body also, but for the source temperature. For black body, see, okay, what is the question I am asking? Let us go to the spectral, what is that? In this it is there?
Which one?
Ha, here it is. So, let us see this. What is this? This is the emissive power of a black body. What is the absorptivity of a black body once you say it is a black body? What is the absorptivity of black body? It is 1 and that is all it is. Now if you say is it dependent on temperature? No, it is not dependent on temperature because it is a black body. Once it is a black body, absorptivity is 1, but emissive power is continuing to be going to a function of
temperature.
That is what we have plotted as Planck's distribution. Is that okay?
Maybe this is not your question. You are having some other question, but you are not phrasing it properly.
Yeah. Is that your question?
Okay. Second question is regarding to the thermal penetration depth for radiation.
So, like how it is depending on the radiation that.
Okay, thermal penetration, the question asked is what is the thermal penetration depth? So, what we have been saying is that this is for participating medium. What we are saying is that absorptivity equal to 1 minus of e to the power of minus k beta L. Actually, that is the thing. Or usually this k beta is given as minus tau s l, that is what they say. This is what is called as tau l together is called as optical thickness. Okay? So, if my tau s l is very less, what will happen? If tau s l is very less, is let us take it as 0. If it is 0, this becomes
1.
E to the power of minus 0.
1.
No, no. 1 upon e to the power of 0.
Is 1. 1 by 1.
1 by 1. Okay. Ha, 1 by 1. So, that is right. That is right. 1 minus 1 is 0. Absorptivity is 0. Absorptivity is 0 means what? Transmissivity is 1. That means this is non-participating. That means it is not affecting my. Non-participating medium. But now on the other hand, let me take tau s l very large. How large? I do not have to take very large. If I take that as 5, as I said in the morning, optically thick, e to the power of minus 5, you will get 0.99. You will get 0.99 something, you will get tau alpha equal to 0.99. What does this mean? What is transmissivity? Transmissivity is almost 0.01. That means it is highly participating. It is highly participating medium. So, how much it is participating? It depends on the thickness or the length or the distance between the one plate to the another plate. Okay, is that okay? So for each measurement, for each participating medium, these taus have to be measured. In fact, these taus are measured in terms of transmissivities, and they are done through FTIR spectrometer, Fourier transform infrared spectrometer. If you still want to know more about FTIR spectrometer, put this on the Moodle, we will answer it. And each FTIR spectrometer will cost around 1.5 crores.
Sir, my question is, what is the absorptivity of ice?
Okay, what is the emissivity, what is the absorptivity of the ice is the question. What is the emissivity of the ice I took yesterday for my natural convection experiment? You have to answer me. Emissivity of ice, we took it as 1. So we said that ice acts as a black body. So emissivity is 1 means absorptivity is also equal to 1. Come on, yaar, I am saying ice is black body. Once I say absorptivity, why it is black body, where is the question of temperature coming into picture? Come on, yaar, I am saying black body, again you are asking me the same question. So ice is a black body, so there is no question of functionality of temperature.
Moment you are characterizing something like a black body, then you have to forget temperature.
That's it. Absorptivity and emissivity of a black body are not functions of temperature. That's all.
I understand what you are saying. Suppose emissivity of a body is 0.5 till some wavelength, and then 1 after that, it is not then
okay.
Same as black body.
Okay. And here in chat we see a lot of questions, balance experiments, for paucity of time we could not take those questions, because tutorial also we had to solve 2-3 problems. Tomorrow we will try to fill in these experiments sometime, we will keep that in the back of our minds, maybe immediately after heat exchangers we will do that. For today we are closing the session, and we will meet you tomorrow morning at 9 o'clock. Bye bye.